This observation was built on our initial studies in trying to understand a version of ALS, a very common version of ALS and dementia associated with a mutation called C9ORF72, which we'll call C9 for the sake of simplicity. It's easier to say. And that mutation, which is found in ALS and frontotemporal dementia, accounts for about 40% of the familial form of the disease, and actually about almost 10% of the sporadic form. Back in 2015, my colleague in that study, and in the current study, Tom Lloyd and I had tried to understand what was the nature of the defect. How does that mutation initiate disease? So with the help of Tom Lloyd and the fly models that he had that were based on this mutation, and previous work by my ex-postdoc, Chris Donnelly, we ended up discovering that nuclear transport was the fundamental defect in this C9 mutation. Nuclear transport, every cell obviously has DNA in the nucleus. DNA is coded for messenger RNA, and messenger RNA leaves the nucleus. But there are a lot of processes that are important. So I just said that the messenger RNA leaves the nucleus. Well, this is a very regulated process. And every nucleus has something known as the nuclear pore complex. It's up to 500 proteins that make up this cylindrical-like object. And there are about 2,000 nuclear pore complexes per mammalian cell. And each nuclear pore complex is made up of individual proteins known as nucleoporins. This is important to our current study. So this beautifully organized structure essentially regulates what gets in and out of the nucleus. The nucleus needs material to operate new proteins. That comes from the nuclear pore. The nucleus releases RNAs in many cases to the cytoplasm to make future proteins in translation. All of that is regulated by the nuclear pore. So it's clear that defects in nuclear transport are being seen now in multiple diseases. We, and actually others, have shown that this occurs in ALS. It occurs in Huntington's disease. And nuclear transport is essential for the cell. One reason why this cellular process appears to be defective is because of the formation of stress granules and their sequestration of nuclear pore proteins. One of the things we don't know is nuclear pore proteins, once they form this complex, these NPCs, nuclear pore complexes, how often do those proteins that make it up come on, come off, or are they just fully stable? We know from other experiments that they're not fully stable. There's a real dynamic property to that. And if they are moving in and moving out of the nuclear pore complex, clearly when you have stress granules, they're sequestering them, and therefore they can't become incorporated back into the pore. And we see that. In follow-up studies from our cell paper, we actually can look at individual nuclear pore complexes and see that they're missing these proteins in the setting of stress. How do you use this information? Aside from helping dissect a mechanism of disease, is there a way to then mitigate this injury? So one would be, what if you could minimize the formation of stress granules? Would you, aside from other cellular processes that stress granules are associated with, could this prevent the injury to nuclear pores? And the absolute answer is yes. And we've done that in both in the paper and follow-up studies, that you can minimize the injury to nuclear pore complexes by preventing the stress granule formation. And one of those proteins by a colleague, Aaron Gittler, known as ataxin-2, we already know that if you remove that, therefore mitigate some of the stress granules, animal models of disease, of ALS, in fact, are really slowed down. And there are already design efforts underway to make antisense oligonucleotides that mitigate, that knock down ataxin-2 as a way of actually slowing the disease. Those are trials actually thought of for patients.